the book of Galatians. And I want to start here at chapter 2 again, just to kind of recap what I ministered to you on last week, on week before last, rather. In this passage, you will find that Peter is being corrected of Paul, by Paul. And his reason for being corrected, correction and reproof, is the way of life. How many want to walk in the way of life? Okay, if you want to walk in the way of life, you must first understand that you are going to be corrected. You must understand you're going to be reproved if you're going to walk in the way of life. You're not going to just be patted on the back and told you everything going to work well. But when Peter was come to Antioch, I withstood him to the face, for he was to be blamed. This is verse 11. For before certain came from James, he did eat with the Gentiles. But when they were come, he withdrew and separated himself, fearing them which were of the circumcision. Insomuch that Barnabas also was carried away with their dissimulation. Now here is Paul saying, that when Peter came to Antioch, Paul, being an apostle like as him, rebuked him before everybody. But when I saw they walked not uprightly according to the truth of the gospel, I said unto Peter, it is demanded of us to walk uprightly. It's demanded of us to walk according to the truth of the gospel. Now, this particular book is about Galatians, is a book to the Gentiles of Galatia. This is a book that Paul had to write to show these people that they could not engage in the practice of the law, which boasted segregation. The law pushed in segregation. In other words, the Jew was separate from the rest of the people on the earth. And now that's why we are not justified by the law, because you cannot be justified with a prejudiced attitude toward anybody. You're not justified in the sight of God. So, but Peter, he withdrew himself, fearing them which was of the circumcision. But when he saw that they walked uprightly, not walking uprightly, I said unto Peter before them all, everybody heard him say it. So many of you all get angry with me preaching certain things in church. Well, Peter got rebuked before everybody. If thou being a Jew, this is Paul telling Peter, liveth after the manner of the Gentiles, and not as do the Jews, why compelleth thou the Gentiles to live as do the Jews? We who are Jews by nature and not sinners of the Gentiles. He's telling Peter, we by nature, the Jews were not those that were supposed to walk in sin. Now, in the law, what Peter had done would not have been sin. If he had been under the law, Peter could have stayed prejudiced, but not under grace. Under grace, Jesus stood when the Greeks came to him in the Gospel of John to see him. Jesus stood and said, if I be lifted up, I will draw all men unto me. Under the law, all people were not welcome to the Jew religion. This is why the law is disannulled. Not because God said, thou shalt not kill, is because there were certain provisions in the law under Christ would be classified as sin. And prejudice is one of them. A respect of person is one of them. So he goes on to say, verse number 17, but if while I seek to be justified by Christ, we ourselves also are found sinners, is therefore Christ a minister of sin? God forbid. Now, here is Paul telling Peter, if we are seeking to be justified by Christ and continuing to sin with this racial foolishness, Is Christ the minister of allowing us to continue to sin? He said, God forbid. For if I build again the things which I once destroyed, I make myself a transgressor. He is saying to Peter, if Jesus Christ come in and build this old spirit among us that he once tore down, he make himself a transgressor. Then he goes in verse 20, I am crucified with Christ. This is what I wanted to get with. I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ that liveth in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. For I do not frustrate the grace of God. And he's telling Peter, for if righteousness came by the law, and he's speaking in terms here in this narrative, if you can stay divided, racial contention, if righteousness came with this kind of mindset, then Christ died in vain. Because he died to bring the world to him. Hallelujah. Give the Lord a hand clap if you will. We're going back to Matthew chapter 10 and verse 37. He that loveth father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. I want to talk to you about the people that are not worthy of Christ today. You don't hear that in church anymore. But this is what our Lord and our King taught us. He that loveth father and mother more than me is not worthy of me. Boy, that's getting pretty deep, ain't it? He that loveth son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. And he that taketh not his cross and follow after me is not worthy of me. And this is Matthew 10, and I'm at verse 39 now. He that findeth his life shall lose it, but he that loses his life for my sake shall find it. I want to talk to you about the ones that will find eternal life. It is the ones, he's not talking about you must go and be killed, or you must get shot, or you must die to find him. No, he said, he, verse number 39, he that findeth his life shall lose it, but he that loses his life for my sake shall find it. He's speaking in terms of a lifestyle. He's not speaking in terms of you got to die. But he's speaking in terms of losing the old cussing life, the old hatred life, the old envy life, the old self-centered and selfish and pride, full of pride life. You must lose that life to find eternal life. But after turning to God and trying to live right, if you find a way to go back to that old life, you're going to lose the life you once had. That's why he said, he that findeth his life shall lose it. Hallelujah. Give him praise if you would in the house of God. I want to go here. Hallelujah. To chapter 8 of Mark. I'm going to go to a few little scriptures here. And we're going to go to verse 34. And when he called the people unto him with his disciples, he said unto them, whoso will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. The cross, as I spoke to you a few weeks ago, it's a dying process of a sinful, law-breaking man. He's telling you that you have got to go through the spirit, the space it takes for you to crucify the old sinful way of living. If you don't go through that space of allowing that part to die in your life, you cannot be his disciple. Let's read it again. Whosoever will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whosoever will save his life, meaning keep on doing the same old thing even though I'm in church. You're saving your life. You join church. You confess the Lord. But you still got the same dope habit. You still want to sleep with your neighbor's wife. You still want to steal and lie. So what you're doing, you're saving your life. You're coming after him, but you're saving the same old lifestyle you had before you got there. Whosoever will save his life shall lose it. But whosoever shall lose his life for my sake in the gospel, the same shall save it. I'm going through this real quickly. I'm going to try to hold firm to what I said. Here in Luke chapter 9, I'm going to all these gospels because all of these writers that walk with Jesus Christ felt it so urgent that they would talk about this cross life. All of them talked about it. Every last one of them. And they all talked about the cross not so much as Jesus' cross, because at this time, Jesus is not preaching about his cross. Through the gospel, Jesus never mentioned his cross. He said he'd be crucified, but he never mentioned a cross for himself. But he talked and preached and instructed us about our cross. You should go to a church and look for the true cross preaching. The churches now preach Christ's cross, but they said nothing about your cross. Nothing about your cross. Nothing. And I'm going to tell you why they don't preach about a cross. I'll share with you this reason why. And I have a little time for that. He says, and here we are in Luke's gospel, chapter 9, verse 23. If any man will come after me, let him deny himself. He's talking about denying the way you walk, different things that you engaged in. And take up his cross daily and follow me. Paul went in one of his passages and said, I die daily. He was speaking about the daily challenges of overcoming sinful habits. Hallelujah. Now he said, you shall take up your cross and follow me daily. He says it again. For whoever will save his life shall lose it. Whoever. He's not talking about trying to die to be saved. He's talking about save the lifestyle. He shall lose it. And whosoever will lose his life for my sake, the same shall save it. You lose it not for to be a friend of a brother or a friend of a sister. You lose it because Christ has demanded. Hebrews chapter 13. The Bible says, as I read to you and have talked to you from the book of Peter, it says, he that suffers in his flesh has ceased from sin. It is the process of the sufferings that you go through, that while, is what causes sin to break off of you and no more memory in your life. Let me read verse 20. Despite what people says. Now the God of peace that brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, that great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect. Let everybody say, he'll make me perfect. Don't be afraid to say that, because the Bible tells you that. Make you perfect. Say it again, make me perfect. Now, I'm going to read it again, verse 21. He will make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. I want you also to turn with me, hallelujah, to the book of 1 Peter, chapter 5. I'm rushing through this quickly, but I hope you can capture it. Are you with me? Here is Peter talking about it. The Hebrew writer just talked about it. Now let's hear what Peter said. But the God of all grace, this is verse 10, who has called us unto eternal glory by Jesus Christ. But listen what he said. After that ye have suffered a while. Now, he called you to eternal glory, but he also calls you to suffer. The Bible said it is given to you on the behalf of Christ, not only to believe on him, but to suffer for his sake. I'm going to read that again. But the God of grace, who has called us unto eternal grace, eternal glory by Jesus Christ, after you have suffered a while, make you perfect, establish, strengthen, and settle you. You cannot be perfect in any category of sin until you're willing to suffer to break that part off your life. Let me explain to you. The scripture said, after you have suffered a while. What does a while mean? Short time. Somebody said it. That's it, man. Short time. When you, meaning that the sin that you're trying to get free from, you're never going to get free from it. Just doing the wrong, coming to the altar. Oh, Lord, I messed up. I'm sorry. Lord, forgive me. Will you give me another chance? Oh, yeah, I forgive you. Give you another chance. You go right back again. Time that desire come again. You dance around that, give in again. Oh, Lord, would you help me with something? No, I'm a suffer now. I'm a pain. I ain't giving into this stuff. A while is a, when you just say, wait a while. This will be worth your while. Meaning this will be worth your little shot. A while means a time span that it takes for a particular thing to occur, or a course of action to take place. It's a time span for a particular course of action to take place. That's what while means. So here's Peter saying, you want to be free from this thing, you got to resist this thing. This time it's presence there trying to pull you one way. Don't go to the phone and dial a guy. Don't go and go on the internet and fulfill. I'm going to suffer. It's not going to take but a while. And I'm coming through this thing. Hallelujah. We don't want the suffering. The alcoholic don't want to feel the lack of alcohol when the urge is there. But it's going to take that suffering. What comfort you ought to have is this. What comfort you should have in this message. The Bible is telling us who we believe in. That this suffering is only going to be a while. It's not going to be always. Oh, I wish I'd have knew that. I wish I knew that when I first got saved and made my first mistake. If I'd have knew that if I just hold on to what God said and not give in to an attitude, personality, or fleshly desire, if I knew I'd just hold on and not respond the way I felt to respond, if I knew in a little while God's going to make me perfect, he's going to establish me, he's going to settle me, he's going to strengthen me. Shout glory to God, somebody. This is the absent message in the church, because they don't want to suffer to get free from sin. Can I read you one more passage? Let's go over here. Let me read you another passage. Lord Jesus, I wished I had the time. Here you go. Let's go to verse number, y'all know all the all of the wagon of the heads and everything, they mock Jesus. And people will mock you when you're doing God's will. Let's read verse 42 as Jesus was on his cross. Remember, on your cross there's pain. Now let's know, recognize Jesus at any time he wanted to come off that cross, he could have. You don't think he could have come off that cross? He said the world was made by him. You got to read your Bible. He said, I got the power to lay my life down and the power to take it again. But I want you to listen at these statements here. And I want you to analyze our society and see just what's going on. Verse number 41, likewise also the chief priests mocking him with the scribes and the elders, saying, he saved others, himself he cannot save. If thou be the king of Israel, let him come down from the cross and we will believe him. I want to give you the mystery of that message. Come down from the cross and the people will believe in you. Churches have understood that if they stop preaching a message of the cross, where the people of God have to take a cross, their churches will get big. So the preachers have come down from the cross. They tell you how bad their lives are. They tell you how many times they fall down, and if it wasn't God, keep lifting me up, and they crowd because they done come off the cross. They don't want to suffer anymore. They don't want a pain to be delivered from the sinful life, and the churches are growing by leaps and bounds. And listen, I very rarely mention anybody's name in my message, but I have got to bring this message to you clearly. I got to make it clear. I remember when Osteen's father preached the gospel of repentance, not a gospel of confession. He preached, you better repent. I never forget when I was going through my little temptation. I turned that TV on and heard that Osteen man come on there and looked like somebody told him all what I was being tempted with. Brother, when that man finished preaching, looked like that. My biggest temptation was me feeling that I couldn't make it. When I heard him preach, I said, this stuff ain't, that's it. Just at the time, I'm feeling, don't nobody like it. Your wife don't like it. You got other sisters that love you. I'll do anything for you. And then here you are, your wife, she just, she devoted to the kids. She ain't got it. And that was her job. But when you're doing wrong, or about to do wrong, Satan can always show you what somebody else is doing. I was bearing the cross. I was suffering the things that I desired, the assistance there. And I was bearing the cross, suffering some time when I wanted a presence there. So when I heard the enemy, when you are going that cross, the enemy is going to constantly try to tell you to come off that cross. But I turned that TV on and heard Osteen's father. It looked like God had me to turn it on right there at that time. And he walked that floor. He said, these old ungodly, hypocritical preachers. He says, some of them just like McDonald's form. They got a chick right here and a chick right there and everywhere. Chick, 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 chick. Oh, God, have mercy on me. For the thought, for the desire. Hallelujah. Not for the engagement. But I knew that desire would lead me. And I'm going to tell you something. Make it up through hearing the gospel. It strengthened me. or this church could never grow to the magnitude of what it is today, because he was preaching a cross message. I remember the time men like Creflo Dollar would preach living right. But now he's recognized, if he come down off the cross and start telling people, now you don't have to live by the Bible, you're going to still go to heaven. You don't have to suffer no more. We can't do it. Can't nobody do it. The churches just grow. And the people believe in them. But I want everybody to know, starting here at Refuge Temple and all of our churches throughout the world, Chief Apostle Wendell Archer is not coming down off the cross. I'm standing on the cross. Whatever trial I have to go through, whatever temptation I go through, whatever challenge me against God, it's got to die. I ain't giving in to it. I know that if I don't bear my cross, I cannot be his disciple. Shout glory to God, somebody.